just a wine sometime.
This is basically the backing tracks from where we play live. We do play live, but we stretch out things like horns, which come across better, or come across as we have layers of horns and stuff behind it, so there's no beats here. So for the anoraks out there, I thought that you can hear the sort of layers of a bass here. It's pure sine wave, which just means you're always going to rattle the speakers. This little thing here, which is really good for the sort of like more you're kind of on a radio or something, these tiny little speakers. And then lastly, a kind of gritty sub which went through something like a culture vulture and a distortion, so you still get that on the middle. So the three layers is basically what's been playing around fields the last 5 years, and that is the original. Those are the ones that were always there. And actually, most of the time we're quite lazy and only use one part. But I think with that one, it became the real signature of the tune. Apart from that, I mean, there's nothing else really that's that worth hearing, apart from, I guess, the horns. There you go. That's all the horns look like. And then,
enter in the dance, plug it in and we begin. Crowd up in the center, they watch me. Watch the way we drop it in a mix time it. Rise and amplifying when we come in with the swing. Just following the back and naturally harmonizing. Climb into position with synchronized it. Live from outer ghetto with maximizing. Sound of the move Armada with super styling.
He's making quite a lot of trance music at the time. I would call one, and he was in a band called the B Foundation. Yeah, exactly. And a band called Katara, I remember. And I came from more of a sort of rare groove background. You know, I've been DJing in quite a lot of clubs. I was in Manchester, I was a student. And there was this sort of interesting mix of his kind of studio now, so my love of music. I've always been much more sort of come from the DJ end of stuff, and he'd come more from the studio end of stuff. And yeah, we started writing together initially because we were running a night. It was called Captain Sensual at the helm of the Groove Armada, which was the name of the night we did. And we used to make records, EPs, on a label called Tummy Touch, which was run by a bloke from Cambridge called Tim Lovely, who's still around. And yeah, we put out EPs with them just to publicise the night. So that was the sort of first purpose, really, of doing it. Yeah, I mean, it was Balearic, you know, that was kind of like, and I remember Tim invented the phrase New Balearic for whatever reason, and then, like, I didn't even know what Balearic was when we were doing it. You know, I thought it was kind of, from my point of view, it was just a lot of like, kind of, you know, being in a lot of disco and that I loved, really. At the River was a sort of real just odd anomaly in terms of a lot of the stuff we were doing, you know, and that record we did, you know, we were in the countryside and, you know, recording in Ambleside in the middle of nowhere, and there was a sample CD by Patty Page. It was on the kind of counter of a kind of, you know, a sort of convenience store that was near us, and so that was just there. And, you know, recorded the trombone by Andy playing the trombone into a speaker and reversing the polarity, which turns a speaker into a microphone. You didn't even have a microphone up there, and that's how we got that kind of sound. And so yeah, the At the River thing came sort of quite left field, and actually after that we started doing quite a lot of really sort of downbeat stuff, which I really liked, you know, and Mix for Language Lab, I remember, that was really great, and we got into a little run of doing quite a lot, that became my little thing. We'd signed to a label called Pepper, which is part of Jive, which is a big sort of, really a pop label, but we were the sort of one sort of dance act on it. And we wrote an album, which was very much in that more chill out sort of vein. And then we sort of got sent back to the studio to really effectively just to kind of write some hits. I mean, you know, like, we'd been in Ibiza that summer, I think. We'd been sort of done our first little spell, and we were DJing in the Manumission Motel, which is quite fun. I think we came back from there, and, you know, in a week we wrote, we wrote I See You Baby with Grandma Funk, who we'd met out there. And if ever the same, we did at the same point. So it was kind of like, it was kind of a reaction to to being sent back in by A&R man to do it. But I'm really pleased we did it, you know, because the sort of greatest pleasures that we've had really from our career has been, you know, it's been the live stuff, and you know, you need the energy when you're doing the live stuff. So doing those songs live has been great, and you know, we had a lot of fun DJing, and the sort of Ibiza's been a big part of our career. So I'm pleased I didn't get kind of stuck in a kind of chill out rut all my life. That was all our career, that was really dull, you know. That album was very sort of downbeat, very much a sort of stoners record, really. You know, we spent a lot of time in the countryside getting stoned, really. And so that was a sort of, you know, but we were kind of conscious that we were going to go back out there, we were going to go out live, and that when we go live, we wanted a bit of energy in the show. And in the midst of us always doing this downbeat stuff, we were still always DJing, we were still interested in sort of club culture. So, yeah, I mean, Superstylin came because we were working with Mike, whose sort of background was, you know, sort of had a Trinidadian background, and so the whole toasting thing came out of that, and it felt quite natural to make a record like that with him. And I mean, we wrote it. Superstylin came off the back of us playing in that little room, room 3 in Fabric, up at the back where we had a residency. And I mean, I said, generally, hand on heart, cannot remember the record it was, but not one of our records that we were playing, and a bass line not dissimilar to Superstylin with that, and Mike started to hit that note, you know, and that combination of that note and that descending bass line was kind of, was the genesis of it all, really. And just remember there being in that room and sort of being a little bit worse aware, just thinking, mustn't forget this moment, and unfortunately, we didn't. I think with dance music with us, you know, bass line always comes first, really, you know, because it's sort of, we both grew up playing bass, we both played bass in bands, you know, so it's a kind of, and it's the glue between rhythm and melody, you know, and so it's kind of like, you can just lay a kick drum down for now, you know, and that's what we'd always do, you wouldn't think about too much about the beats. And so that bass line came first, you know, and probably just threw a loop on top of it, and for a long time that was probably in the track, you know. So yeah, everything sort of flowed from that, you know. Once you had that bass line, and I mean, the pivotal moment with that song, actually, for ages it used to be that Mike would sort of come in when the bass line came in, and it's sort of pivotal moment when we realized that wasn't the way to do it, was to bring Mike in on the drop and bring the bass line halfway through, so you kind of get that sort of rising energy with a vocal, and then when the bass cuts halfway through the vocal, that was kind of, I remember that moment where we sort of brought that vocal forward sort of 8 bars or 16 bars, whatever it was. And so instead of it kind of the chorus hitting on the bass line, you had that same da 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 da, and halfway through that, and that tension of the two. And I just remember that moment, I remember it distinctly, sitting in our studio in Lazy Moon with that, and that moment happening, us both looking at each other and realising that something sort of extraordinary had happened.
Tying the dance, plug it in and we begin. Crowd up in the center, they watch me dividing. Watch the way we drop it in and mix timing. Rise and amplify it when we come in with this swing. Follow the vibes and naturally harmonizing.
Without that happening, in our careers would be, our lives would be slightly different, you know. It's probably the most important thing musically that ever happened to me.
Armada, we super styling.
Yeah, I mean, bits of it. We didn't have the sort of capabilities you had with sort of soft samplers and things then. So everyone had hardware samplers, and most people had archives, but we had these things called emus. I still got one of them somewhere, but you know, like they were sort of 20-second sampling time. So it was a very different kind of thing. We were using Logic probably, or maybe even still Cubase at that point, but you know, Logic to record the vocals and the horns and that. Had a really amazing desk. We had a massive AMEC desk that was enormous, and not a lot else really. Yeah, there's some drum and bass kind of loops slowed down in the drops and stuff, but yeah, it's pretty much our sort of our own making. The kick drum's just a 909, you know, and there's a couple of little rhythm loops, but yeah, it's definitely more our own than some that I can't mention. Probably about a year, because that's the way we worked with that album. You know, we sort of Like now, it's very much like, you know, we tend to start a project and see it through from start to finish, but when they're kind of album times, you're sort of juggling, you're sort of kind of plate spinning all the time. So we drop from, go from sort of Edge Hill with some mad, you know, 32 piece sort of string arrangement, dubbed out thing like that, and then going back to that. And, you know, and I quite like writing like that. I kind of think that sometimes, you know, Andy's quite different. Andy will go to the bitter end with something.
Come up, operator, make the music play time.
You know, I came across all the sort of Trojan crew through that. So yeah, no, it's a real, and it's kind of, and we sort of, well, everyone kind of loves dub, and everyone loves reggae. It's my sort of music. It doesn't matter what background you come from. So it changed a lot of people's opinions about us, I think, and it brought us, it took us from being a kind of, you know, just a sort of dance music band to something bigger than that, and a band that could headline festivals, and you know, and I think it gave us a real lot of confidence in the way that we then started developing our live show. You know, we realised that, you know, we wanted to be that kind of band, you know, we wanted to kind of have those kind of moments, and so that kind of worked as well up until its peak, which would have been like, you know, closing the second stage in Glastonbury in sort of 2008, 2009, which is, I've got someone on the telly, which looks amazing. I'm so pleased that, in a way, that became our preoccupation as a band, actually, was how good we could be live, you know, because there was no kind of, like, there was a lot of politics about being around a label and releasing records, and a lot of that was quite tiresome. But there's no politics about going on stage with a band and a crew of people you like, and you know, and just playing to an audience. So I think we just kind of quite focused on that. We did quite a lot of releases on a label called Hypercolor last year, which is a label I really like, which is, you know, doing that sort of, you know, Brit house sort of vibe in the loosest sort of terms. So we've been making some records with them, which has been fun. We're going to get back into a bit of DJing. We'll do Ibiza again this summer. Yeah, so it's been, but kind of writing-wise, it's been quite slow, really. We just started to get back into it. We kind of decided, we had last few months, we took things fairly easy. But yeah, no, I'm just starting to kind of, to write again. I did a project a few years ago, kind of thing called Sugar Daddy, which is more sort of funk based, and I'd like to kind of, there's some really great kind of labels around doing that sort of Soul Clap, Wolf and Lamb, people like that I really respect. I'd love to kind of, I thought the Kindness album last year was amazing, so for me that's a kind of where my heart is that kind of sound. So I think I'm starting to kick around a few ideas at the moment with stuff like that, which wouldn't be GA based. And then Groove and Model wise, yeah, I think just we're quite enjoying the sort of making house music again. I think it's quite enjoyable, just the sort of the way things have moved back to the kind of dub plate days. You know, you make a record on a Monday and it's kind of out, and it's out online and uploaded by Friday, and that's quite cool. That's quite a nice way to work. So we've got a few dub plates and things coming back out. We've just done a remix of a track called Walking on Sunshine, Arthur Baker, Rocker's Revenge thing, which is a real sort of seminal tune for us. So we've just done a couple of mixes of that, which has been great. So it's like basically cranking back into gear just about in time for the summer. I never felt like, you know, right, we made this conscious decision that we're going to go back to the underground, but I think, yeah, we didn't feel like we particularly wanted to make radio-based music, particularly, you know, like commercial-based music wasn't really getting us excited, and I didn't really feel that's where our hearts are at. And, you know, we made Black Light, which is a real departure, and it's a record I'm enormously proud of, but it was kind of, for me, that, for both of us, I think, that sort of closed the book on terms of writing an album, you know. It was a sort of really, it's a great record, I'm really proud of it, some great music on it, but it was just a sort of demanding record to make. And then to tour, and actually the sort of last gigs of that tour, and a mix of that more rocky stuff we were doing with Black Light, with things like Fogma and Superstylin, I See Babies, the best we've ever played live. We did stuff then. I think I questioned things less, you know. Like I think you just did, you know. Like when you've got that kind of that real brio of just like you're going in there. You think you know the answer to everything. It's easier in a way. And I think I probably second guess myself a lot more now, and I'm probably listening to other stuff. I love music in a weird sort of way. I love music more now than then. Then it was kind of like it was a job, and I was always, whenever I heard a piece of music on the radio, I was always comparing our stuff to it. I could never just enjoy it for a piece of music. I was always like, is their kick drum better than us? Or what's that bass sound? now I can enjoy music for what it is, you know, and I do a show on BBC Six every few months, and I've got a real kind of music lover's appreciation of music. I last few years I've got into music in a way that I never did when it was my career. It's still my career in a way, but I don't, so it's a nice time, it's a different sort of time. So when I'm producing now, it's more like I'm writing, you know, I'm just having a bit of fun with it, and I'm just, but there isn't that same sense of pressure around it. In a way, it's kind of, it's an odd time, because it's, in some senses, it's harder and harder to make a career, I would have thought, of music, but it's a really great time for making music. I think creatively, it's better than it's ever been. So I think it's great, because I don't think you need to really subscribe to any kind of sound, you know, like when we were sort of making records, like, you know, and I remember Superstylin was kind of like almost sort of part of that kind of big beat sort of scene, you know, and there was always a scene, and it was trance or big beat, and it was always quite dominant. I think what's really nice now, starting out, there is no dominant scene, you know, you just got to do what you do with absolute confidence, and whoever you respect in that field, you know, listen to that and try and bring that in. But I think that's all you got to do now, is sort of stay true to yourself, and I think it's a nice time. You have a million different aliases, and everyone, you know, you can make house music like this, you can go and make dubstep like that, and you can go and I think that's all it's about, is doing things with total conviction, really.
Baby, just recline.
At Point Blank Online, you've got two methods of interaction with your tutor. Firstly, you've got the weekly online masterclass, which is in real time. And then also, we've got feedback on your assignments, and that's known as DVR. So the online masterclass is a one-hour session you get with your tutor every week. You can ask questions about lesson content and get instant feedback, and also demonstrations on the fly from their computer desktop with our streaming technology. DVR stands for Direct Video Response, and the concept is really simple. You upload your Ableton Logic or Cubase project file to your tutor, he downloads it, and then pushes record on the screen capturing software and evaluates your work, so basically giving you one-to-one feedback. You see all of the mouse movements and any parameter changes made by your tutor. It's kind of like sitting in the studio over their shoulder watching what they're doing whilst they work. We have found the DVR process has truly revolutionized the way that we teach online, and the results speak for themselves. Book your place on the course now by visiting pointblankonline.net.